And we have arrived at Final Destination 3, which came out in 2006. We have James Wong back as the director, with the first and the second movie somewhat sharing some characters, and the second one being a direct sequel. The third installment is a movie completely standing on its own. There is a new cast, a new setting, and yep, they do mention Flight 180 once, but that's basically it. This is a standalone movie, watchable without the previous entries. This is the first Final Destination movie I have ever seen. And it was a very brief first impression, let me tell you. Back in 2006, I remember it clearly. My father was watching this movie in the living room, and I recall walking right down the stairs, joining him for a bit, curiously. It's this part, right over here, where Kevin gets his upper sliced off, that... Well, I don't think I've ever fled back to the stairs that quickly in my life. I was horrified. It holds till this day the title as the fan favorite of the franchise, or even outside. Seriously, people seem to really love this movie, claiming it to be the best Final Destination out of all, surpassing the original. But is it really? It's quite the title to claim. Is it worthy of it? And do I agree with it?
You can run, but you cannot.
So, years after Flight 180 have passed, and we are bringing the high school students back. They are at a carnival, celebrating their graduation. I'll bring this out right now. This movie is the most distinct Final Destination out of all. It has a very unique and consistent atmosphere and tone going on, lingering on carnivals and amusement parks. The old classic mix of horror and carnival. It never gets tired. And this movie does everything in its power to make it eerie, scary, foreboding.
Subtle?
No. But I personally don't care. I do have to point out that pay close attention to the images shown during the credits. Just saying. After the credits, we cut to our group of teenagers with our new lead, Wendy, played by Mary Elizabeth Winstead. She's here with her boyfriend Jason, her best friend Carrie, and her boyfriend Kevin. Along the way, we also have our ditzy popular girls Ashley and Aislinn, alumni and professional pervert Frankie, the jock Lewis, and our local goth duo Ian and Aaron. All of them are heading to the main attraction, the roller coaster called ever so appropriately the Devil's Flight. Wendy is not feeling this ride, and after some persuasion of her boyfriend, she reluctantly goes with her friends anyway, even though the signs are flying around her face, but okay. Once aboard the ride, the tense build-up starts, and those who are familiar with the franchise by now can guess that this is where the opening disaster is gonna take place. So let's talk about it! The roller coaster sequence is my personal favorite premonition out of all in the franchise. Surprise, surprise. Just the idea alone, the originality of it. I have never seen anything like this in any other movie. How it builds and builds with that heart-beating music when they go up the lift hill. The music is still Shirley Walker's, by the way. But did I say that I liked the music in the first movie? Oh, she is really outdoing herself here. And how the cheerful joy quickly transitions into total panic when Frankie's camera's hit kicks in. Yeah, I can go on and on and on about how much I love this scene. The roller coaster does exist, by the way. It's called the Corkscrew, located in Vancouver, which also happens to be the place where a lot of these movies are filmed. These actors had to ride this thing, I think, countless times to get the shots right. Naturally, there's also some CGI in there. Of course, that's inevitable with a piece like this. And the CGI model of the roller coaster is, what, 5 times the size of the real thing? It's insane. After that horrific imagery, Wendy snaps out of it and freaks out, Alex style, but with a little bit more crying. This really turns off some people and they leave the ride. Her boyfriend is forced to stay on the ride for some asinine reason. He is asking, no, demanding to be let out, but they just refuse to do so. Pretty sure that as long as the ride doesn't start, if someone requests to be let out, you have to let them out. Someone who is let out though is Frankie, whose camera was what caused in the premonition all the trouble with the roller coaster. Yeah, everybody and their ancestors have talked about the camera incident. People are still debating about it. How does the ride still crash without Frankie and his camera? It shouldn't. It is a plot hole. You can come out with all the excuses you want, but no, this is a plot hole. The writers themselves admitted it. They did forget about this little detail. And I don't wanna be here all day, so...
Of course, it's clear from the start that the roller coaster is not in the greatest condition, and let's ignore the fact that roller coasters don't use fluid hydraulic systems for their restraints but compressed air. Lewis gets his restraints pushed down more, giving the system a little kick where it starts to leak. This happens before the premonition. The camera gave an extra push to it and it ruptures, therefore the restraints open during the ride. But the camera also damages the wheels of the carts, and this is what causes the front part to derail and the rest to stop in the loop. In real life, Wendy's freakout delays the ride, therefore giving the hydraulic system more time to leak. So even without the camera, the restraints would still open. The real life accident would just be people flying out of the ride, which is just horrific. But the derailing and the crash, like in a premonition, it shouldn't happen.
Now that that's out of the way, can we ask ourselves the next question? Does it matter? No, it doesn't. Not to me. I still love it. What, is this your first day on the job? Haven't you seen the previous Final Destinations by now and how often they break basic reality and physics?
Nobody cares!
We done? We good now? Can we move on, please? After this wonderful sequence, the writers thought, oh yeah, we still have to film the rest of the movie. Some time has passed and Wendy is not in a very happy place, you know, losing her boyfriend and her best friend and all. Ashley and Ashlyn approach her and invite her to join them for a tanning session.
That was so nice of us.
Whoa, okay, you have to tell yourself that. Not very sincere, is it? Nah, whatever. At least they are trying to be kind. Kevin briefly mentions Flight 180 and Wendy just storms off. No idea why she's so dismissive of it, considering what happened at the carnival. Meanwhile, the Ashleys arrive at the tanning salon, going for a quick bronze. Not only does the manager take a private call outside, Ashley also takes her slush puppy inside the tanning room, despite instructed not to, and both the back door and front door are as of now closed off. The girls get comfy and to stay in theme, Love Roller Coaster from the Ohio Player starts. I have to take a little detour here and talk a bit about this particular song, which I happen to love, by the way. For the longest time, I had no idea there is a very disturbing legend going on about it. You see, at some point in the song, you can hear a soft scream in the background, presumably from a woman. There are several spooky and weird conspiracies debating what this scream is. And the most well-known version of the rumor is that it is the sound of a woman being murdered. The cover of the album, which is Honey by the Ohio Players, depicts a nude model kneeling atop of what appears to be a sheet of glass, dripping honey all over herself from a ladle suspended above her head. This glass is actually fiberglass, which reacted with the honey, and it fused her skin to the fiberglass. They managed to free her, but it ripped the skin off her legs, and her career was as good as gone. So yeah, she just so happened to burst into the recording studio while the Ohio Players were recording Roller Coaster and starts threatening to sue the band for everything they're worth. The band's manager stabs her to death right there in the control booth, and that's the scream you hear in the song. What the hell? Where did this come from and why are there so many people who believed it? It's debunked, by the way, it's a total hoax. The real source of the scream and the origins of the rumor were explained by Ohio player Jimmy Diamond Williams. There is a part in the song where there's a breakdown. It's guitars and it's right before the second verse. And Billy Beck does one of those inhaling type screeches. People were asking us, did you kill the chick in the studio? The band took a vow of silence because that makes you sell more records. No such thing as bad publicity, I guess. But it kept people questioning. Apparently it wasn't commonly done to merge a scream into a song back in the day. Though they simply just wanted it to be there because of the whole rollercoaster thing. Back to the movie. Remember Ashley's slushy she was not supposed to bring in? Yeah, of all the places, she placed it onto the electricity box, and the water dripping from it caused it to malfunction. The beds are heating up, but by the time the girls start to get uncomfortable, a series of events lead to the beds being blocked by the CD shelf, preventing them from getting out. Oh. Okay, stop, 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 stop. Please, please stop. You know what? They should have stayed on the ride. Okay, they should have stayed on the roller coaster. I know that's terrible, but yeah, at least it would have been over and done with. This is taking forever. It's agonizing to watch. Not to mention that they should have gone into cardiac arrest by now. The human heart can't take intense heat like this for very long. Eventually, and I do mean eventually, their beds overheat so much to the point of breaking into flames, cooking the girls alive with a very clever transition. I wonder how many tanning bed salons saw a decline in profit after 2006. Did this scene do to tanning bed salons what Jaws did to beaches? Who knows? I have never been in a tanning bed and never plan to. Completely unrelated to this scene, because this would never happen in real life, let's be honest. But A, I don't need skin cancer, thank you very much. And B, I have zero patience to lay down in what is essentially a human microwave and stay there for what, 15, 30 minutes? Boring. I'd rather stay a pale vampire or, you know, go out in the real sun than doing any of that bullshit. This is not for me. The funeral scene goes a bit hard on the picking up signs of death, with Wendy even showing, well, pictures. She has made a vague connection between the photos she made from everybody at the carnival and their potential fate. This realization came to her during the tanning session, when she was uploading the photos and saw that the photo of the Ashleys had a weird yellow flare around them, as if they were incinerated. Wendy and Kevin discuss this further and look at Frankie's picture to find clues, since he was sitting behind the Ashleys. They queue up in a drive-thru, but all of a sudden the very same truck that was present on Route 23 in the second movie goes rogue, and it is about to ram into them. The car next to them blocks them from directly leaving their car, but they do, however, manage to escape just in time. The driver in front of them is less lucky. Yep, that was Frankie. If it wasn't for the mudflap girl necklace, I honestly couldn't tell you that, because look at him. Is there seriously nothing holding this engine in place? Can engines really fly out of the cab like this? Confused and shocked, Wendy and Kevin retrieve back at Wendy's, where they discover they were looking at the wrong picture. Of course. Okay, let me tell you quickly how I feel about the whole photo holds clue to death thing they are doing in this movie. On the one hand, I love the idea. The movie is a bit more back to formula than the second movie, but it still tries to do something different by adding to the lore. Figuring out the clues in the photos makes the audience guess along with the characters, and it makes you question, do you want to know beforehand how and when you are going to die? Or do you want to stay blissfully ignorant? It gives a bit of opportunity, you know, to flesh the characters out a little. Especially Kevin, he is going through it at some point. On the other hand, the whole photo thing does not make sense in the plot in of itself. These photos were all made before a roller coaster crash. Therefore, everybody in these photos was supposed to die on the roller coaster. Why would there be clues in these photos to deaths that weren't supposed to happen in the first place? Wendy and Kevin rush to the gym, where they find Lewis, who was sitting behind Frankie, therefore they assume he is next. They try to explain their findings to him, but of course, every single Final Destination movie has to have that one pompous, testosterone-filled meathead who doesn't believe them. In Final Destination 1, we had Carter. In Final Destination 2, we had Eugene, and now we have Lewis. But, you know, Carter was kinda going through an arc, and Eugene transformed into a bit of a likable character. So, what do we have for Lewis?
He's gonna have 4 Super Bowl rings on his fingers. Lewis ain't afraid of no death. Fuck death!
Ah, I see. He stays a loud dickhead who wants to bone himself so badly it would make Gaston blush.
No!
No one's got us well cleft in his
chest like Gaston. 3 death sequences so far, and this is the second one where really it's just the characters doing it to themselves. You just had to angry hump the machine that hard, my man? At this point, Death is just sitting in his old man chair eating popcorn and watching the show. These people are freaking lemmings. It's getting better though, believe me, it gets better. Wendy and Kevin head off to warn our next contestants, the local god duo Ian and Erin. So now you may have noticed that unlike the other two previous movies, this movie is practically a hop-on, hop-off tour bus. We go to one character to warn them, this fails, and we move on to the next. The middle part of Final Destination 3 is nothing more than this. Where the original Final Destination showed the entire thought process of the main character figuring the mystery out, and all together with the interrogations of the police, the second movie had the whole main cast working together. This movie does none of all that. It makes the middle part of Final Destination 3, aside from the death sequences, slow and less interesting to sit through. The conversation we get between the remaining characters in the warehouse is a little interesting to a degree. Ian over here is our second non-believer who truly tries to play along with Kevin's story and suggests that someone at the end of the list shoot off themselves to save the others. We as the audience, of course, already know this won't work, since you can't off yourself if it's not your turn yet. But they do discuss the idea of death being either a person or a force. The exposition talk is interrupted by a chain reaction of events, and Ian gets saved right in time from the falling wood that was about to crush him. Erin gets the short end of the stick, and holy shit balls, that's nasty. The tanning bed scene is the most mentioned death when it comes to this movie, but this is a close second. Mar from Home Alone got off easy compared to this. I have used a nail gun once, and when not used, they have a lock on them to prevent, well, exactly this. Pretty sure they don't just go off whenever they feel like it. But it's still cool death and done completely practical. Seriously, watch the documentary of this movie, which was, if I remember correctly, on the Blu-ray and DVD as an extra feature. There is also the Choose Your Own Fate feature, but I'll get to that later. Now that they have failed for the third time in a row to save their classmate's life, except for Ian, Wendy and Kevin try to figure out who the mysterious people in the roller coaster were. The ones behind Ian and Erin, but in front of Kevin and Wendy. Turns out, it is Wendy's sister, Julie, seen by her lucky bracelet, together with a friend. Now how in the widespread world didn't Wendy notice her sister going into the ride? Yeah, okay, she was wearing a hoodie, but there is still no way Wendy didn't notice her. Wendy was at the back of the ride, having a perfect view of everybody. Maybe Julie got seated when Kevin and Wendy tried to go in the front, but Frankie stole their seats? But then Wendy would have walked past Julie's seat and surely noticed her. This is weird. The time has come to watch their own photos. Kevin is working at the tricentennial festival of their town and apparently should avoid anything fireworks. Wendy's photo is very minimalistic, with Jason's face blurred out, and McKinley, the name of both Ian and their school, on her shirt. Wendy races to the festival, trying to find her sister and her friend. Kevin beats her to it, however, and wants to escort Julie from the festival. But as she flips him off, a scared horse goes nuts and pulls Julie along with him to go on a not-so-joyride. From here on, a lot of stuff happens in a very short time span. Julie gets saved right before turning into a bear claw. The Dutch one, not the Danish one. Julie's friend number two does turn into a bear claw. She apparently was the one who joined Julie on the roller coaster, but who can tell at this point? And Kevin gets horse kicked. That kick alone should have killed him, but okay. The sisters manage to pull him away right in time, laying down in the grass with blood and guts all over them for the 100th time in this movie. A very unhinged Ian enters the stage, bitter about what happened to Erin. Wendy thinks that Ian is the clue in her photo and that he is out to kill her. But after the fireworks barely miss Ian and destroy the support arm of a cherry picker, said cherry picker comes falling down right into Ian, leaving a mess. Ian, my man, you had all the time in the world to just step to the right or something. How slow is your response mechanism? Now to who's asking, Ian was supposed to die in the warehouse. Why was he the clue in Wendy's picture? And the answer is, he never was. Take a closer look at that cherry picker. Yep, That's meant for Wendy, but Ian blocked her path and therefore he was taken out by the cherry picker instead of Wendy. Our last three remaining characters head off slowly as the camera focuses on Wendy's camera. The movie concludes. Well, that was a lot. Now, time to discuss what we all just Hello? What's that? The movie isn't done yet? Oh, right. Of course. My mistake. Yeah, no, joke's on you. This is how the original cut ended. But once again, test audiences didn't like it. They were left with a little bit of blue balls. Really, this was the climax of the movie? So they shot an entire new scene that starts right after the festival. 5 months have passed and Wendy is on a train along with her new friends. And the very same feeling she had right before the rollercoaster crash starts to plague her once again. But you know, the singer, the ads and the constructor's voice don't really ease things. Her sister Julie boards the metro, and when Wendy spots Kevin, she starts to get really anxious. What follows next is a very violent and cruel derailing scene. The metro smashes into the wall, gets torn left and right, and bodies drop very fast. When everything comes to a halt, Wendy is the only one still alive, but her legs are screwed. Oh? A premonition? Again? Two visions in one movie? That's new. However, this time there is no way of getting out anymore, and thus Wendy, Julie and Kevin finally meet their cruel end. Okay, now the movie ends. And? Are the claims true? Is this the best Final Destination? Yes. Definitely yes. Without a single doubt. And I don't think it's objectively the best. After all, the acting, pacing and storyline of the original Final Destination are still technically the best. But what is it about number 3 that attracts a lot of people so much? I think it has to do with one major thing. The death scenes. This movie has by far the most unforgettable deaths out of the franchise. Heck, maybe even in general horror. As great as the previous visions were, we have all seen car crashes slash pileups and plane disasters in cinema before. This was the first time the franchise picked a very specific phobia that still resides and relates with a lot of people. Roller coasters. Haven't we all imagined at some point doing a scary ride? What if? Well, this movie answers that question gladly. Now, people, please. Roller coasters are overall very safe, and the pileup in Final Destination 2 is way more likely to happen to you than a ride fatally malfunctioning. But it has happened in the past, of course. Restraints not tight enough, brakes that don't work. It's scary. Really scary. Aside from the vision, the accidental deaths in this movie are pure crazy. They hold nothing back here and come up with some of the weirdest situations you can possibly imagine. And the movie begins and ends with a violent premonition. What more can you ask for as a horror fan? Solid movie, very spectacular. The things I'm a little more critical about is the characters themselves. Most of them are just downright unlikable. Yeah, I get it. Giffith's unlikable characters, so you'd love to see them die. But, you know, give us something to work with here. The first and second movie had some characters that went through some development. It's not a ton, but remember what kind of movies these are. It was at least something. Final Destination 3 is just here for the spectacle gore. It's a popcorn bloodfest. These characters, if you can call them that, are meat sacks, waiting to be slaughtered. And in my book, that's a-okay. The movie makes more than up for it, with fantastical practical effects, creative and original death sequences, once again fantastic music, and serviceable acting. Wendy especially is great. Mary Elizabeth Winstead is great at acting scared, anxious, and crying. This is her strong suit, and it's used to its full potential here. One last thing I want to talk about before we conclude is the DVD Blu-ray feature Choose Their Fate. It's an interactive little game, you can call it, and it's exactly as the title says. You make a choice, and it leads to a completely different take of some of the scenes in the movie. For example, the tanning scene. The alternate version has one of the girls escape her bed, but gets knocked out by the shelf. She wakes up and manages to free her friend, but the exposing wiring in the bed electrocutes them both. I actually like this one better than the theatrical one. It's shorter, and the girls actually had a chance to escape here. The theatrical one just had them helplessly trapped, undergoing their fate. Another alternate version is with Frankie, where Kevin and Wendy do rescue him from the flying engine. He ends up in jail, if I remember correctly, and dies there instead. It's a neat thing. They took the effort to shoot different versions of one scene, and I love such dedication to the craft. Even the opening scene has another version. So, final verdict. Is it melodramatic? Yep. Is it dumb? At times, yeah. Is it over the top? You believe it. Do I love it? Yeah. Have you seen the length of this movie compared to the others? Despite it being flawed on several levels, I adore this movie. It's the one that made me a fan of the series, it's the one I love to see people's reactions to the most, and it's the one I have seen by far the most. I definitely see why this is the most popular entry in the series. Its strength lies in its originality. The ideas in this movie are bonkers, executed great, and you can see people had a blast making this. The practical effects, the stunt work, the merging of CGI, the effort they took to shoot several versions of one scene, and the fact that we get two premonitions for the price of one makes this a very easy sit. Eye candy for any horror fan. Yeah, of course, not everybody will agree, but if you love some crazy creative gore fest packaged in a sinister high-budget popcorn flick, this is absolutely your pick. Well, three down, two more to go. Which one is next on the list? Oh, crap.